Thank you all for coming. My name is Kristin Devin. I'm a professor at Loyola University Chicago, and I work with undergraduate students who want to be Spanish, French, or Latin teachers, and I help them learn how to teach language. So it's similar, it's English as a foreign language. The foreign language you all teach is English, and then the foreign language my students teach is really mostly Spanish. So some of the examples that I'm gonna show you today will be teachers teaching English in videos, but some will be teachers teaching Spanish too, because it's similar to what you all do, just a different language. But the one I wanna start with is talking about how we can increase interaction. Because a lot of times when we go in classrooms, what we see is the teacher speaking 90% of the time and the student speaking 10%, right? And we want to change that. We want the students speaking a lot and the teacher speaking less so that the students get better with practicing the language. So we're going to start out with one activity that I like to do in my classes at the beginning of the year or at the beginning of a new lesson called Find Someone Who. And what you have to do is you have a table with these different statements in it, and you have to find a different person to write their name in each box. So for example, the first box says, has been teaching English for more than 10 years. So you'll walk around the room and you'll say, have you taught English for more than 10 years? If the person says yes, and the person's name is Conchi, then you'll write her name in that box. So then you'll have to go to someone else and ask them another question. Have you attended METworks, or did you attend the METworks conference last year? And for example, if Peregrina says yes, then you'll write her name in that box. So you have to have a different name in every box. Okay? So stand up, walk around, and meet your colleagues.
Yes, I'm also.
What were the strengths or the positives of this activity? What was good about it?
We could talk.
Okay, so you could talk?
Yes.
You can know a little bit more.
The classmate is all.
And even if we don't know each other, we could know something like, you know, in a friendly way about.
Yeah, so when you go into a new place and you haven't talked to anyone, you don't really want to raise your hand or volunteer, because you don't know who they are or what they might think. So it's a great icebreaker building community. Because you could only write one name in each box, you had to talk to lots of different people. And also, you were using language, as you said earlier, you were talking. One thing that students often struggle with in the foreign language is they don't get many opportunities to ask the questions. The teacher's always asking the questions, and they're just answering, right? So with this activity, you have to ask questions and answer questions. Another thing you can do this with is with different, if you want to teach grammar and you're teaching different tenses, you can keep it in the present tense. Do you like to play soccer? Do you like to study? Where do you live? But you could also use the past tense if you're working on past tense. Did you go on vacation last summer? Did you go to the park last night? Did you? You can use the past tense. Or you could use the future tense. Will you, or do you want to be a fireman when you grow up? Will you go to university here in Panama City? So you can be creative with the ways in which you use this. So I have this slide, why is interaction important? You can't see the photo very well, but this is me a long time ago when I went to Spain with some friends and I was just learning Spanish. But in my Spanish class, we read a whole lot and we wrote a whole lot, but we didn't speak very much, and we didn't communicate interpersonally. So I get to Spain my first week, and I thought I really knew Spanish, and it was really, really hard. And after 5 days, I was feeling frustrated and homesick, so I went to McDonald's. Yes, and I ordered some chicken nuggets, and I wanted the sauce, the sweet and sour sauce it's called, that you dip them in. And I didn't know how to say that. So I'm at the counter and I'm like, quiero, por favor, salsa, pollo, salsa. And she just looked at me like I was crazy. She was just like, and so I go back to my table and I sit down and I just started crying. All of the frustration from the week of not being able to communicate just built up. And I was so upset. And so whenever I think about my own classroom and how I need to get students talking, I think about that experience and how I needed more practice listening and talking and less practice reading and writing in that case. Have you all had that experience?
Yes.
Yeah, with English, it can be very frustrating sometimes. So I work a lot with teachers, as I said earlier, and I'm gonna show you two videos. I'm going to show you one video of a brand new teacher who's learning how to teach Spanish. And I'm going to show you one video of a teacher who's been teaching for 25 years and teaches English. And I want us to think about these two questions as we watch these two videos. In which classroom is more communication occurring? In which one are the students talking more? And what are the teachers doing in each classroom to get the students to talk? What are they? So let's look at these and see what you notice. This is Juan. He is a brand new, he's an undergraduate student learning to teach English in Chicago, or learning to teach Spanish in Chicago. And this is one of his lessons.
Okay, that's brilliant. Ahora, lugar, ¿dónde estamos? Lugar. México DF. México DF. DF es Distrito Federal. Ahí estamos. Y ¿Y esto qué es? Sí, el ángel de la independencia. Muy bien, será. ¿Y es? ¿Qué es esto? ¿Un edificio? No. ¿Qué dijiste, John? ¿Qué es? ¿Qué es? Una estatua. Sí. O un monumento también puede ser. Una estatua.
A lot of quiet time, right? He's having a little bit of trouble.
¿Cómo es? ¿Cómo es la ciudad? ¿Es moderna o antigua? Moderna. ¿Qué es esto? Muy grande. ¿Y es un rascacielos? ¿Quién vive aquí? ¿Quiénes son ellos? ¿Quiénes son? Es una civilización moderna, ¿sí? ¿Cómo se llama? Yo soy de México. Yo soy... ¿Cómo se llama?
Mexicano.
Mexicano. Los mexicanos viven aquí. No hay sombreros aquí, en esta ciudad.
Okay, we'll turn this down. Would someone mind turning on the lights, please? Oh, thank you so much. Before we look further, what did you notice so far about this?
The teacher is talking like a parent. Yeah. He's doing no participate at all.
Okay, the teacher is doing most of the talking, sure. What else did you notice?
He's not confident about what he's saying.
No, actually. He's not.
He didn't prepare.
Well, it's interesting you say that, and we're going to come back to this. Because he did have a very detailed lesson plan.
Right. Yeah.
And he had all of his materials present, but he may not have thought through exactly what he was going to say and how the students were going to respond, right? But we all can relate to this. We were all new teachers once, right? The other thing you said that I thought was interesting is you said you heard a lot of parroting. So the student would say something, and then Juan would repeat exactly what the student said. Lots of teacher echo, we call that, right? Okay, now let's look at Anna. I'm sorry, would someone mind getting the lights again? Thank you so much. Anna has a whole lot of experience. This was a research study I did in Sweden. So she was teaching English in Sweden, and she'd been teaching for 25 years. So let's see what her classroom looks like. Oh, I forgot to turn this back on.
Oh, this is too easy. English, of course.
What do you have in
the
asking them to guess what this is.
It looks like that. It looks like fudge.
Yes, but it doesn't even taste that good.
It's not a job.
It's a great thing for Christmas.
Yeah, it's dried fruits.
Yes, lots of dried fruits. Are you afraid?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What did you notice about this teacher as compared to Juan, the last one we saw?
Here, the teacher was giving the students the opportunity to talk, to share with the class, but in the other clip, the teacher was like telling, explaining to the students the picture or the image that they had. But here, she was letting the students to share between them, just as what we did before.
Right, yeah. So the teacher, instead of describing what was on the screen herself, she was letting the students use language to describe it. What else did you notice?
I think, for example, the first one,
yeah,
we saw a picture using the 360%.
Uh-huh.
So the professor tried to show, you know, like too much information.
Okay.
And maybe this go to straight and just use one.
Yeah.
You know, she worked just in one, so the concentration could be better in that, you know. If you have a lot of, maybe you can, but if you use just one toy, maybe you learn and get more information about just one thing.
Yeah, because the students knew exactly what she was asking about. The other thing, I don't know if you could notice this because you might not have been able to hear the students well, but they were making lots of errors when they were talking, but it was okay. She wasn't stopping them to correct them and say, oh no, we don't say it that way, we say it this way. That wasn't the point of this activity. It was to talk about school subjects, right? And so she let them create with the language, say whatever they wanted to say, and they felt more comfortable volunteering, right? Let's look more at the language they were using. So I think coming back to our questions for viewing, in which classroom was more communication occurring? Juan or the English-speaking teacher Anna? Yeah, in Anna's classroom for sure. Now this one we're gonna look at the transcripts to understand. What were the teachers doing to get the students talking? So if we look at Juan, I've highlighted all these questions that he asked in that transcript in red. So he starts by saying, ¿Dónde estamos? They tell him Mexico City. He points at that statue, remember that? He said, ¿Esto? ¿Qué es? Yes, ¿qué es esto? ¿Un edificio? No, ¿qué dijiste, Juan? ¿Qué es? ¿Qué es? And so he's asking the same question over and over again, right? What do we see down here? ¿Cómo es?
¿Cómo es la ciudad? ¿Es moderna o antigua?
Right, yeah. So we see he's asking lots of different questions. This is the rest of it. We've got again more. ¿Qué es esto? ¿Quién vive aquí? ¿Quiénes son ellos? ¿Quiénes son ellos? Now let's look at Anna's. What do you notice already? Her questions are again in red. We have just a few. Shall we go on? Is this too? This is too easy, isn't it? She says, really? What is it then? We look at the next page. She asks the students, have you tried it? Yes? What are you noticing here? Again, can you do that? One of the students said that she thought that dessert was like figgy pudding. And the teacher said, I'm sorry, I'm not really sure. Can you look that up and tell me tomorrow? And then a student mentioned something about New Zealand, and she asked the student if she had been to New Zealand at what age. So what differences are we seeing between Juan's lesson and Anna's lesson?
Perhaps he made a lot of questions.
He had a lot more questions. So that seems like a good thing, maybe, to have lots of questions,
He made a lot of questions, but they are the same questions.
Yeah, so he's asking the same thing over
different,
and over again.
Different ways, but are the same questions, so.
Great.
And in the other classes, the teacher let the students perform according to their experience or what they know or knew about the picture. So she did when like, you know, they acquired confidence. So each one of them go talking about whatever they thought it was or according to their experience.
That's a really great point. Yes, I'm going to come right back to that.
Yeah, it wasn't like a conversation in the second class versus the first class. And you could very easily, like, oh, have you been there? Like, what did you see? Or, like, brought more out from them. And it's all just short answers for her kids, but more sentences with more words and building that confidence in speaking English.
Exactly. So we can classify questions into two different types, right? We're going to come back to that one. But we have questions where there is a known answer. We call those display questions. So when we look back at Mon's transcript, where are we in this video? Is there a right answer to that question? Yes, they were in Mexico City. Here, look at this statue. What is it? Is there a right answer? There's one right answer, right? In real life, how often do you ask someone an answer or question, excuse me, you already know the answer to, right? If I ask you what time it is, it's because I don't know, not because I want to see if you know what time it is, right? And so sometimes when someone asks you questions where you feel like they're just testing you, you kind of, you're like, it's a Statue of Independence, it's Mexico City. You might not really get excited about answering, right? But with Anna, she's asking the students questions we all like to talk about ourselves, right? Someone asks me if I like Panama City. I went to the canal. I went on a tour of Casco Viejo. It was so much fun. I'm going to keep talking because it's a lot of fun, right? So let's keep looking. I'm going to show you another video of Juan later on so you can see how he got a little bit better. But another thing that's really important to think about is how we respond to students when they give us an answer. So, if I ask a question and the student responds, and then I evaluate that question or that answer by saying something like, oh, very good, or that's correct, then it's just one, two, three, done every single time. Question, answer, evaluation. Question, answer, evaluation. Every single time. If instead I follow up, then the communication keeps going. So I ask students, oh, what's your favorite sport? And the student says, my favorite sport is baseball. And I say, oh, do you play baseball in the park over here? And the student has to respond again. Or I might say, do any of the rest of you also like to play baseball? So just the way I talk, the questions I ask, and the way I respond to students' responses can change the entire shape of the classroom, can change the learning that's going on. So let's look back here at Juan. Let's look at, now I have in orange the way he followed up to a student's response. So take a minute, talk with the people at your table. I'll leave each slide on for about 30 seconds or a minute so you can see, oh, we can talk. So you can see how is Juan responding to students, and then I'll go look at Anna and see how she's responding to students, okay? So go ahead.
It was very artistic, and she was dancing.
Okay, so what are you noticing? Did either teacher seem to evaluate or follow up more? Did you think either teacher's responses were more natural, more authentic as they are in real life? Or did you not see much difference between Juan and Anna and how they responded? What'd you talk about?
Anyone? Well, I think that Juan evaluated himself because he talked, he said yes, he alone, he didn't make the kids have their own idea.
Yeah, yeah, he did evaluate himself a lot. Oh, muy bien, Juan. What else did you see? Anything else? Anything else you spoke about or talked about?
Sometimes when he responds, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, no.
Sometimes when he responds, he doesn't sound like too sure that it was that or not.
Sufficient quantity of questions. So sometimes what I see actually with new teachers is they'll go in the classroom and they'll teach about something for 10 minutes before they ever ask a question. And so they may have lost students in minute two. Students may not know what they're talking about, but the teacher doesn't know because they haven't asked a single question yet. So we want to see teachers ask questions from the very first minute of the lesson to make students sure that students get it. So that's important. Sometimes when you're working with new vocabulary, it's important to start with yes-no questions and then go to these either-or questions and then go to open-ended questions. So if I make some words, what are some, okay, so English words, types of shoes. Women might wear platform shoes and clogs. If I asked you what type of shoes you wear right now, if you have never said those words, you might need to hear them a bit more. You might not be ready to use them. So I might just first say, oh, do you have any clogs at home? Do you have any platform shoes? All you have to say is yes or no. Then I might go either or. Do you prefer clogs or platform shoes? Now you've heard the words a lot. We've seen pictures, we've talked about them. Now I might move to open-ended questions about those where you have to use more language. So you start with the questions that have answers that are very familiar, then move to questions where it's one or the other before moving to the open-ended. A different variety of questions, questions that scaffold and help students get the answer. So if I ask a question and the student is just silent, instead of saying it in Spanish, I might ask them more questions to help them understand. Clear questions that make sense. Start with easy questions and then get to difficult ones. This is all on the METwork's website, so don't feel like you have to write this down. You can go on the website and see this presentation from home. Use a variety of response types. That's what we just saw with Anna and Juan. So sometimes saying yes and what else? So responding in different ways, responding naturally in authentic ways instead of saying, muy bien, muy bien, muy bien, right? Using simple questions that students understand, following up. So these are the characteristics that we think. These are really important when asking questions. We need students to, or teachers, to be able to do these things. Now here's how they scored. We have four teachers. We have Sally, Stella, Haley, and Jessica. And if we look, and this is how well they did. They could score 1 to 3 on each category. 1 meaning they didn't really do it at all. 3 meaning they were really good at this. So if we look at this next slide, the things that they were really good at, where all four of them got almost 3 points, they were all very good at asking simple questions. That was pretty easy. They all did a good job of asking a lot of questions. That's pretty easy for new teachers. They could also ask clear questions. But what was really hard for new teachers is using a variety of response types to students' utterances. So when students respond to a question, the teachers tended to respond the same way every time. They tended to say, muy bien, every time, or es correcto, or excelente, or something like that. They didn't vary it a lot. And that's very connected to this one, natural reaction to student responses. They weren't very natural, right? In real life, if I ask you what time it is, and you tell me it's 11:45, I'm probably gonna say, oh, thank you. I'm not gonna say, muy bien, right? Because that would not be natural. Mm-hmm. So that's what we found these teachers struggled to do. So let's see. Go back and you find, oh, the next video. Let me talk about this first. The teachers were better at those aspects of practice for which they could plan and practice. So this is, comes back to exactly what you all were saying earlier. You said Juan didn't seem very prepared, right? He had his lesson plan, he had his Google Earth ready, he had all his materials, but you can't plan necessarily for how to respond to students because you don't know what they're gonna say. It's completely unpredictable sometimes what students are gonna say. Anna has a lot of experience. She has 25 years. She probably has a general idea of what students are going to say in response to her questions. Juan doesn't. He's brand new. So he can write out every question that he wants to ask students, but he might not know how they're going to respond. What else? Let's see. The aspects that were more context dependent, that depended on how the students responded, how the classroom was set up, how students were behaving, those were difficult for teachers. And then finally, the aspects that dealt with interaction between the teacher and students were quite difficult. So let's look at Juan. This is him again after he's had a semester, a few months of teaching. See if he's any better. We'll see. Some people think he is, some people think he isn't. We'll see. Thank you. Oh, that's
great. So, en la tercera parte del capítulo 1.
Talking about reading.
Se llama Don Quijote. Él escoge su nombre, ¿verdad? Sí, Don Quijote de la Mancha. Chayán, ¿qué vas a decir? Sí. Quiso una mujer, ¿no? ¿Por qué? ¿Por qué quiere una mujer, Don Quijote? ¿Por qué?
Think about the questions that you ask. and how much you're talking versus how much your students are talking. Do you think this is something you need to work on, or do you think you, I don't know, do you think you're more like Anna, more like Juan? What do you think? Yeah?
Okay, well, on the public school here, we might be more like Juan. Because they don't speak the language. And of course, we might have to speak English, translate, and they have to tell us the answer and translate to them so that they can tell us the answer in Spanish. Or they might use Spanglish. And so we might be more like one. School like English speakers, we might be more like Anna. Because it's easier for us just to open, bring something, and they say, what is this? That's it, then they're going to start describing it. What more do you think of what it is and what it has? So we can be both. Depending on which place we are. Public school, we might be more one, or even worse than one. So, and even in public school, if some of you might agree with me, if you teach in Rio Bravo, where people speak a little more English, or they have here, they, even though they don't speak it, but they understand, it's easier for them to get to answer and to tell you something. But if you go to the interior, where they have no idea about English, then you will be one on the reading. So it's hard. So that's what I'm saying. Depending on where you are, you will be either
great
or.
Point. And I think you brought up a very good point too, is that the communication may have seemed a little halted and difficult, but he was using only Spanish, and his students were beginning students. So sometimes we might have to ask more of these simple questions, and students might respond very with short responses in the beginning, but then we can build up from there, right? I think that's a really good point, but I think it's important to think back and say, yes, we can judge Juan, but how are we doing it ourselves? So there are three takeaways that I would like to leave you with today before we go upstairs to reflect. The first one is, when you're planning your lessons, write out some of the questions that you want to ask in advance. It can be a lot of work to write out your whole lesson plan, but if you write out some of the questions that you're going to ask to students during your lesson, and think about moving from those yes-no questions to the either-or questions before you get to the open-ended questions to scaffold instruction, that'll help. That will help you a lot. The next one, take time to reflect on the way you talk in the classroom. So what I like to do is I might set my phone on record, or a computer on record, set it to the side, and then after the lesson, go back and listen to a little bit. And listen, how much am I talking versus how much are my students talking? And what am I saying in the classroom? Are my questions getting students to participate a lot? Or am I responding very good every time they answer? So that's another thing. Sometimes you think you're doing one thing, and then when you listen to what you're actually doing, you realize, oh, I wasn't doing that at all. That was here. And again, this PowerPoint is available on the website, so you can go back and look at this later or share it with anyone. And finally, the important thing to remember is that change is gradual and it takes lots of time. I think Juan made a little progress from the first lesson we saw to the last one we saw, but that took several months. And you know, now, this 2 years later, if you go into his classroom, you'd see a lot of really great stuff happening, right? It's just, we can't change everything overnight. We're not superheroes, but if we can pick one or two things to work on at a time, then you can make a lot of change. So we are going to go back up to the third floor now for the closing and reflection. But thank you all so much for coming to my session.
Thank you.